Today I have with me Dr. Arjun Chacko, who is a consulting neurosurgeon. And today we're going to speak about brain tumor. So what are the common symptoms of brain tumor?
Basically, the symptoms of brain tumor depends on which part of the brain the tumor arises from. Generally, in neurosurgery, we divide the brain into two arbitrary regions. One is, of course, what we call the eloquent region, which is very important for all the vital functions. And the non-eloquent region, which is, you could say, expendable brain, or maybe not so important for our routine daily functions. So when it is an eloquent region tumor or a tumor arising from eloquent regions, you generally tend to notice early because the symptoms are very hard, very definite, and very early. Whereas non-eloquent region tumors, because inherently the brain is not used as much, you tend to detect it very late because the symptoms are softer symptoms. So an eloquent region tumor, you could have symptoms like difficulty in speaking, weakness of a limb, changes in behavior, maybe changes in the way you perceive things, the changes in which the way you behave in social situations and such similar situations. But in non-eloquent tumors, you hardly notice the symptoms, and generally the first symptom in such tumors might be the symptoms that are related to increase in the pressure within the head. You see, the skull is a closed cavity, so once a tumor grows inside it, it kind of puts pressure on the normal brain. Mm-hmm. And that is what we usually refer to as raised intracranial tension, which is, means the tension inside the brain rises. So the symptoms that are related to an increase in the pressure within the skull is what comes in non-eloquent region tumors. Such symptoms are basically vomiting, headaches, changes in vision, blurring of vision, maybe difficulty in walking, general drowsiness, and such soft symptoms. So it can be a whole spectrum of very hard symptoms to very soft symptoms.
What are the things you do to, you know, find out that it is actually a brain tumor?
First and foremost, you need to get a qualified neurological examination done. Okay. Because most of these soft symptoms might be accompanied by subtle clinical signs which can be picked up on a clinical neurological examination. So once you undergo a formal examination and you have or the doctor seeing you has an idea as to which part of the brain that might be a tumor, then he can subsequently order the best possible investigation. If you look at, there is a host of investigations in today's world which are available for brain tumors. But if you want to pinpoint on one good investigation, I'd probably say a good quality MRI. Okay. So a 3 Tesla MRI would be the ideal or a gold standard investigation for most brain tumors. But then depending upon whether it's arising from a bone, whether it's near the base of the brain, or whether it is arising from a vessel, it can be anything from an angiogram to a CT scan to maybe in some rare situations, maybe even a Doppler of the brain. And then of course these recent investigations like PET scans and all those things you have probably heard about in media, all those investigations are also done. But the gold standard is probably an MRI scan. Brain tumor is a very general topic, but there are a set of brain tumors which are basically genetic. Or in the sense, it is some problem with the chromosomes that you have inherited, or some mutation that has happened later. So there is a subset of tumors which are genetic, but probably for most of the brain tumors, it does not have a particular genetic predisposition. And you really can't say, you say such diseases are sporadic, or in the sense, there is no specific genetic link to causing these diseases.
Possible reasons could be that maybe lifestyle or...
Actually, radiation in all its forms incriminated to cause all sorts of tumors, and it's pretty much similar in the brain too. And not even just the occupational exposure, even patients undergoing radiation for some other tumor.
Okay.
Some could have a brain tumor because of the radiation exposure due
there
to the treatment for. There is a possibility.
What about the treatment options once you find out you have a brain tumor?
For most part, brain tumors have to be surgically treated.
Okay.
There are only a very rare subset of tumors, probably some tumors that are arising from what you call as blood cancers or blood-related cancers, which might disappear with steroids or with medical treatment. Other than those very few subset of brain tumors, most brain tumors require surgical treatment.
Okay.
And the extent and the nature of the surgery might vary, but that would be the basic treatment for a brain tumor would be a surgery.
Does it like stop only at the surgery, or then after that, you know, how in cancer they have surgery, then chemotherapy, radio, does that also...
Well, that essentially would depend on the nature of the brain tumor, whether it's a malignant tumor or whether it is of a benign nature. Generally, malignant tumors require what you call as adjuvant therapy.
Okay.
What do you mean by adjuvant therapy is basically either a radiation or a chemotherapy, which is either given just before the disease is managed surgically or it follows a surgical management. So even in brain tumors, malignant brain tumors of late have started to benefit from radiation as well as chemotherapy. For years together, it was predominantly radiation for brain and not much of chemotherapy. But now a lot of promising new agents are coming, which are which have shown to have definite benefit in malignant brain tumors.
So are there any cases where you don't need surgery for this brain tumor?
Straight off surgery may not be indicated in certain tumors. In certain situations where the tumors are very huge and you need to downgrade the tumor, or you need to do, decrease the tumor a little before you go in for a final surgery, maybe you could have an adjuvant radiotherapy where you can have radiation before the surgery and then maybe take up. This is probably not so much applicable in neurosurgery as in other surgical fields, but essentially the benefit comes in neurosurgery because of the very fact that you cannot touch the normal brain, quite unlike other surgeries. The advance of science and with the modern technologies we have at hand, that subset of tumors are probably going down because we can approach more and more tumors with each passing day, with each advancement. But there are some tumors, essentially the eloquent region tumors, like I said, which you can't really handle surgically because they are essentially arising from the brain and from the very important part of the brain. So in which case, if you remove those tumors, you're essentially removing very important part of the brain, and naturally that will show up as significant weakness or symptoms in the patient post-operatively. So it's always a balance. You have to decide whether you have to approach the disease aggressively or you have to get a better quality of life patient for the patient post-operatively.
How long would it take the surgery and then the recovery and...
Neurosurgery has changed a lot probably in the past 25 years and more so in the last 10 years, because the old dictum was neurosurgical procedures are generally procedures with a lot of morbidity, where the patient has long hospital stays, patient has weakness, and patient might have permanent weaknesses once they finish their surgery and go off. But not anymore. Generally now, what is expected as a dictum is a patient who walks into a neurosurgical setup walks out maybe within a few days, which is as short as that can be for any general surgery. So for all practical purposes, for most of the neurosurgical procedures, we are looking at a hospital stay of maybe 3 or 4 days discharge and get back to work as early as possible. There are these rare complex tumors, which are fairly rare, which might require prolonged stays, prolonged physiotherapy and rehabilitation, and maybe it can take up to 3 to 6 months to get to an optimal physiotherapeutic rehabilitation. But for most tumors, we can expect it to be as short and as pleasant as the other short and small surgeries we are used to. And thankfully, that is where technology has brought us today.
Is there any particular symptom you would say that is like a surefire like sign of a person having tumor, brain tumor?
See, generally, when you say brain tumor, the general confusion is between a neurological brain disease, which is generally a brain disease which can be treated by medicines, which is a forte of the neurophysicians, or whether it's a brain tumor where you should consult a neurosurgeon. So generally, that is where the whole confusion is. And few parameters that can probably help a layman decide is, neurosurgical conditions inherently tend to be progressive. That means this week you are worse off than you were the previous week, or maybe this month you're worse off than you were the previous month. Or if it's rapidly growing, maybe within 2 days you feel that you're not as good as you were 2 days back. And that is one. And then you will have a definite evolution of symptoms. Whereas in most of the neuromedical conditions, what you have is probably on and off symptoms and on and off worsening. And you may have a long plateau phase where you don't really have much progression of symptoms, maybe years together where you don't have much progression. And then you have an attack where you again get to some worsening of symptoms. So if you have symptoms, where you feel, okay, I mean, it's pretty easy to decide, okay, there is, when you see behavioral changes or you see weakness, that, okay, maybe something's wrong up there. So once you have such a scenario where you feel, okay, that something's wrong up there, and you feel, okay, it's progressive, it's worsening with each passing day, okay, that is a definite sign probably that it's something neurosurgical. And then, like I said before, if it is accompanied with features of increased intracranial tension, that is features of tension being high inside the skull, that is headache, vomiting, visual loss, difficulty in keeping yourself awake, drowsiness, all such symptoms, you can have a fairly good guess that it could be a neurosurgical problem.
So, what are the risks involved in, you know, the surgeries regarding this?
The risk actually is dependent upon the area of the tumor as well as the nature of the tumor. If it is an essentially malignant tumor, that is a cancerous tumor, the risk of giving a deficit to a patient is always high, in which case we balance the surgical excision with giving a quality of life to a patient. You don't want a patient who already has only probably 2 years to live with a serious handicap or a serious weakness. So in such situations, you balance the resection so that you give the longest, highest quality of life for the patient rather than go totally after the tumor and go for a full tumor excision. As far as some tumors which are arising from very near to important nerves or important structures of the brain, the risk in neurosurgical pursuits is definitely much, much, much more than most surgical pursuits. Which is why it is, it's not the flavor of the month. You know, people don't want neurosurgical conditions. They want other conditions. They can even go for a heart condition, but they really don't want neurosurgical conditions. So the risk is definitely high, but thankfully, because of better intraoperative monitoring, better pre-op imaging, and in general, better technology as far as the vision or the surgical instrumentation is concerned, because of the improvements in all those fields, we are able to say that we have reduced the risks to make neurosurgery almost comparable to any other branch of surgery.
Any possible preventive measure you can take, or because the whole causes is also so undefined, like maybe lifestyle choices is something you could say?
Not so much, because unlike a lot of lifestyle-related diseases, most of the brain diseases are not really lifestyle diseases, other than the point you made before regarding radiation exposure. There is not much of a subset of neurosurgical conditions which are really related to lifestyle. So probably the best thing you can do in a neurosurgical condition is to have an early detection rather than prevention.
What basic tests would you say to the people who are watching there that they should go for?
There is not a specific screening program, unless breast or cervical cancer, which has a specific screening program. After this age, you have to get regular examinations. There is not anything that would really be prescribed by a neurosurgeon as far as the screening is concerned. But in general, if you have to be a keen observer of yourself, is what I can suggest. Because if you feel that your faculties are declining faster than they should, then it's probably a subtle indication or an early indication of brain-related pathology. Because other than that, it is very difficult to have a screening, because in earlier phases, the only thing that can probably help you is imaging, which is scanning. And the two frequent scans are hardly good for you. So it's not something that can be screened. But if you keenly observe yourself and look for soft symptomatology, not to the point of being paranoid about it, but still, if you can be keenly observant about it, generally it helps.
What about the recurrence rate of this brain tumor?
Recurrence rate generally depends on the nature. And if it's a malignant pathology, generally, you know that, okay, you might be able to treat it adequately, but someday it might be coming back. But as far as benign tumors are concerned, which is a lot of those brain tumors, it is not a bad scenario. A lot of these tumors where we are able to get good, satisfactory and complete excisions, the recurrence rates are pretty much very low, in the sense that once you undergo a surgery for most of these benign conditions, you don't have to think about undergoing the same surgery probably in your lifetime. So it's only there are some malignant tumors, maybe. But then malignant tumors also there is only a very small subset of diseases where you have to undergo surgery again. Because once it's a malignant, high-grade malignancy, naturally after surgery, you'd be sent for chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So once in a radiated brain, you're unlikely to operate again. So it's only one very small subset of patients where it's malignant and you operate again. And secondly, a very small subset of benign tumors, which are rapidly growing, which might require resurgeries. But it's still a very, very, very minor subset.
What about the other neurosurgical conditions?
Other than the tumors, there are the neurosurgical conditions which are related to the blood vessels. Okay. Generally, problems with the arteries or the veins. Arteries are basically what takes the blood to the brain, and vessels are veins are what takes the blood back. So, a whole set of arteriovenous malformations are there, which are basically not tumors, but some abnormally developed blood vessels which are causing the problem. And another subset is, of course, aneurysms. Aneurysms are probably pretty famous because some famous person has died of aneurysms. So everybody knows about it. So aneurysms are basically bubbles that arise in the blood vessels. It's an inherent weakness. And over the years of development, that has bulged out like a soft balloon. And that ruptures, giving rise to potentially lethal brain hemorrhage. So that is the same, probably the most common presentation of arteriovenous malformations also, which are basically abnormally formed blood vessels. So this is another whole subset of neurosurgical conditions which are non-tumorous, which are potentially lethal, but if treated adequately, it can be deemed to be permanently cured.
Aneurysm and embolism the same thing?
Not really, because aneurysm is in general a point of the blood vessel which is very weak. And where over the years, the pressure of the blood flow within it has given rise to a balloon-like outpouching of the blood vessel. Mm-hmm. So what has happened is it's really a thin balloon filled with blood which is ready to rupture any moment. Oh. And embolism is generally anything dislodged and traveling in the blood. So if you have a clot in your leg and it breaks up out from there and then it travels in the bloodstream, that is what you call as an embolism.
I read somewhere in some magazine about something, parasites in the brain.
Yeah, parasites probably not so much in the West, but in developing countries, parasites in the brain is another subset where imaging features would be very similar to a tumor, where a lot of you might confuse it in MRI or a CT scan for a tumor because it has a very similar appearance. There are only very few indications where you need surgical management for parasites. Mostly it is to biopsy, in the sense like if you are not conclusively sure in the imaging that it is a parasitic infection, then to get a biopsy or to get a tissue from there to examine and to confirm that it's a parasitic infection, that is probably the only region where you need a biopsy or a surgical intervention for parasites. For all practical purposes, for tuberculosis or probably neurocysticercosis, which are probably the two commonest parasitic infections, for both of them, it is eminently treatable medically. It is only for a biopsy or to get some tissue diagnosis that you really need to go in for a neurosurgical intervention.
Is there any part of the brain which you would declare as inaccessible, which you would not even go that deep or that far to, or it would pose that big a risk that you would not operate on it?
There are certain regions, actually, even though the places you cannot reach in the brain is slowly coming down, mm-hmm. there are certain regions where there's a region called brainstem, which is basically the part of the brain which controls all our involuntary activities, mm-hmm. our heart beating, us breathing, sweating, all the things that happen to our body without us even knowing, but which are so vital to sustaining our life. So brainstem is the region that controls all those things. So when it is tumors within the brainstem or within the deep part of the brainstem, we generally are very hesitant to go about it because there are very few corridors through which you can approach a tumor within the brainstem. And some parts of brain are forgiving, some parts of brain are very unforgiving. There are parts of the brain where you can take off a few millimeters and the patient may not have much of an issue, but the brainstem, like some other regions of the brain, are very unforgiving, where even a millimeter of imprecision can cause serious problems to the patient. So such regions are there where you may not be able to access surgically. In such scenarios, actually, there are some recent developments where you can have focused radiation, where you might have heard of gamma knife or a cyber knife. Okay. All these are basically advancements where you can focus the radiation. It's not like you're frying the whole brain with radiations. You can, with millimeter precision, you can focus the radiation onto just that part of the brain or that part of the tumor, whereas sparing the rest of the brain from radiation damage. So in such inaccessible situations, this gamma knife or cyber knife might be a very good option.
Is there anything else what people should know about brain tumor which I might have missed out on asking you?
All I would say is get an early consult. There is nothing like maybe I should wait it out for 2 more months. Okay. That is not definitely never a good idea, because a smaller tumor on any day is easier to remove. The lesser number of structures it is pressing or it is affecting, the easier to remove it is, and the better quality of life you get post-surgery. So early consultation and generally a keen watch of the symptomatology is the best way to go about it.
Paranoia is better than, you know, just waiting it out and like, okay.
Not so much paranoia, because considering the whole percentage of people who might be affected by these conditions,
okay.
You don't want really everybody to crave for an MRI every day of their lives.
Okay. And that was a very interesting discussion regarding neurosurgeries and brain tumor with Dr. Arjun Chacko. Thank you all, and till I meet you again, this is Angel Rosen signing off.